I believe the rest of us are in the book of Mark and chapter 7. Book of Mark, chapter 7. So we started a study, 6-8 weeks ago, looking at all the commandments of the New Testament. Jesus said, if you love me, what? Keep my commandments. So that is how we show our love for our Savior, is through obedience. But that means we have responsibilities to know what the commandments are. Amen? It's one thing to say, I want to obey them, but you need to know what they are. And so far we've looked at, 36 of them. And we'll start grouping them up on the screen soon. But just as a way of review, we've looked at the two great commandments, which is love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, soul, mind, and strength. And the other golden rule, as the Bible calls it, the royal law, which is to love your neighbors yourself. So according to Jesus, those are the two greatest commandments. Then we've looked at 8 of the 10 commandments so far. Do not kill, do not commit adultery, don't swear, no covetousness, honor your parents, don't steal, don't bear false witness, and have no other gods. And then this next category I've called Christian character. You can call it whatever you want. But these are what we've looked at so far. Follow Christ, shine for Christ, pray and fast, give, no covetousness, trust the Lord, be content, put God's kingdom and his righteousness first, enter at the straight gate, or be born again, of course. Beware of false prophets, don't fear man, but fear God, learn of Christ, don't be idle, but serve, watch, be faithful, and be baptized. So that's what we've covered so far under that kind of Christian character category. And then we started looking at some things, how to treat one another. And so far we've looked at forgive and reconcile, judge not, and don't hinder children from getting saved, and to serve one another. And then we've also looked at some virtues that God wants us to emulate. We need to be perfect or holy. We need to be meek, lowly, honest, and compassionate. So that's the ones we've covered so far. And then some sins that Jesus said for us to avoid so far. Evil for evil. Watch the tongue. Evil thoughts. Blaspheming. And I think that's it. Then for family, no divorce except for fornication. And for government, pay our taxes. So those are the ones we've looked at so far. For those of you that are taking notes. But I will put them on the screen eventually. I will have handouts. We'll get this. But today we continue walking through them. And that brings us to the book of Mark chapter 7. Where Jesus lists for us just how wonderful we are as humans. You'll like it. So who would read Matthew 7, 21 to 23 to introduce this to us? Matthew 7, 21 to 23. Any volunteers? Mr. Scott, thank you. Matthew 7, 21 to 23.
For from within, out of the heart of men, proceed evil thoughts, adulteries, fornications, murders, thefts, covetousness, wickedness, deceit,
lasciviousness.
Thank you. An evil eye, blaspheme, pride, foolishness. And all these evil things come from within and defile the man.
So just one of the many lists in God's word showing why we need Christ. Amen. Because we are so wicked. And we've covered a lot of these, but the one that came up that we haven't covered yet is that word deceit. We haven't seen that word yet. And so we'll talk about deceit today, that God doesn't want us to be deceitful, and then we'll carry on. So let's pray and study the commandments. Thank you, Lord, for the privilege to open your word together and study it. We pray you'd guide us in your truth, Lord, and Lord, that these would sink into our hearts and become just a part of us in our daily walk. So use the word now to change us, speak to each one of us. We commit the service to you and love you in Christ's name. Amen. So this word deceit, we all know what the word means, to be deceitful, but it actually is also translated guile in other parts of the New Testament. So and it gives us a better understanding of what he's saying, that we're not to be deceitful or have guile. So we'll look at some scriptures on this. Romans 1:29, Brother Howard, if you would read that. And 1 Peter 2:1, Philip. And Mark Zeus, 1 Peter 3:10. So, Howard, Romans 1:29.
Being filled with all unrighteous fornication, wickedness, covetousness, maliciousness, full of envy, murder, debate, deceit, malignity, and whispers.
Another listing of our great traits. But notice deceit is mentioned there in Romans 1:29. Then 1 Peter 2:1, Philip.
Wherefore, laying aside all malice and all guile and hypocrisies and envies and all evil speakings.
So Peter here is telling us to lay aside all guile. So we are never to be deceitful. We are always to be straight up with everyone. There's no exceptions. And then Brother Mark Zeus, 1 Peter 3:10.
For he that will love life and see good days, let him refrain his tongue from evil, and his lips that they speak no guile.
That they speak no guile. So we're never to speak things that are deceitful, that aren't honest and truthful. So one of the things that we're to avoid is this sin of deceit. So back to Mark 7, the next one that's listed there, which we haven't covered yet, is this word lasciviousness. Kind of a big word. It basically, in modern language, means like unbridled lust or lewdness, being vulgar. Basically, you know, how our society is today. It's a good description of just how things have become, hasn't it? Just this unbridled, just satisfy the flesh at all costs. That's all that matters, is just make the flesh happy. There's no such thing as sin because there's no such thing as God. That's people's basic attitude. So this word lasciviousness is also translated wantonness in other parts. Same basic meaning, and that is this unbridled lust. And that is something that God wants us obviously to avoid. So Romans 13:13, Beth, you want to read that? And Galatians 5:19, Robin, and Maggie, 2 Peter 2:7. So Beth, Romans 13:13, we're looking at the sin of lasciviousness that we're to avoid. No problem.
And now abideth faith.
Romans 13:13. That sounds like 1 Corinthians 13:13. Romans 13:13. Let's jump ahead while she finds that. Robin, Galatians 5:19.
Now the works of the flesh are manifest, which are these: adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness.
Galatians 5:19 and 20 is another listing of our wickedness. But notice lasciviousness is mentioned there. Okay, Beth, Romans 13:13.
Let us walk honestly as in the day, not in rioting and drunkenness, not in chambering and wantonness, and not in strife and envy.
So there's that same Greek word that's translated lasciviousness. It's also translated wantonness. And then 2 Peter 2:7, same word, but notice a different translation or English here, Maggie.
And deliver just Lot, vexed with the filthy conversation of the wicked.
So whose conversation was he vexed by, Lot? The cities of Sodom and Gomorrah. So that helps us to get a picture of lasciviousness, doesn't it? Because that same Greek word here is translated filthy conversation. So that the usage of the word conversation there is not talking about our what we speak, but our demeanor, our behavior. And it's saying that Lot was vexed with the filthy conversation or the lasciviousness of Sodom and Gomorrah. So that helps us to get a picture of lasciviousness, unbridled lust, essentially. And it's another sin that we are told to avoid in God's word. The next one is back to Mark 7 again. So let's go back there. And that is an evil eye. Now, this is not the evil eye of superstition. That's not in the scriptures. Because you've probably heard of that from, you know, other cultures where people think they have this power to cast a spell on you by giving you the evil eye. That's not what this is talking about, as we'll see. So notice Mark 7 again. After he mentions deceit and lasciviousness, he mentions an evil eye. And if you understand what he's saying there, he's talking about looking for evil. So someone out looking for an opportunity to sin, essentially. And Jesus, if you go to Matthew 6:23, kind of expounds upon it a little bit. So let's go to Matthew 6:23. Brad, you would read that. And Jackie, Luke 11:34. So Brad, Matthew 6:23.
But if thine eye be evil, thy whole body shall be full of darkness. If therefore the light that is in thee be darkness, how great is that darkness?
So if thine eye be evil, thy whole body is full of darkness. Well, our eye itself, he's not talking about the physical eyeball, is he? He's talking about what we're looking for, what we're out looking at and looking for. He's saying if that be evil, it makes us completely evil. And so that's what an evil eye is. It's out looking for wickedness, looking for an opportunity to sin, looking for evil. And then Luke 11:34, Jackie.
The light of the body is the eye. Therefore, when thine eye is single, thy whole body also is full of light. When thine eye is evil, the body also is full of darkness.
So full of darkness, this evil eye, essentially, it's a person, everybody that's a sinner is dark, but it's a person that's literally out looking for an opportunity to commit evil. And that is another sin that we are to avoid. All of these from Mark chapter 7. Any questions up to this point? That was number 39, by the way, for people who are taking notes. Not that those numbers are going to matter in the end. Anybody? All right, go to Mark 9 then, as we continue just walking through the scriptures as they appear. And verse 50, our next commandment is to have peace with one another. Brother Saw, could you read that? Mark 9:50.
Salt is good, but if the salt have lost his saltiness, wherewith will ye season it? Have salt in yourselves and have peace one with another.
So here God, he's not talking about there's a lot of pieces in the Bible, isn't there? There's the peace we have with God through Christ. We're talking about in Romans chapter 5, we have peace with God, the Lord Jesus Christ. There's the peace of God that we have received as we're surrendered to the Holy Spirit, the peace of God to keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. This is a different peace. This is having peace with one another. In other words, getting along with one another, having peace. And this one actually shows up a lot in the New Testament, this command, as you'll see. So let's look at them. Romans 12:18, Howard, Philip, Romans 14:19, and Mark Zeus, 2 Corinthians 13:11. So we'll start there. Howard, Romans 12:18.
Possible as much as lieth in you, live peaceably with all men.
Live peaceably with all men. Sometimes it's not possible. I like how God said, if it be possible. There's going to come times when it just isn't. Romans 14:19, Philip.
Let us therefore follow after the things which make for peace, and things wherewith one may edify another.
So the things which make for peace, it's talking about with one another. And then Brother Mark Zeus, 2 Corinthians 13:11.
My dear brethren, farewell. Be perfect. Be of good comfort. Be of one mind. Live in peace. And the God of love and peace shall be with you.
So live in peace. So again, this isn't talking about the peace in our soul that we receive from the Holy Spirit and His Word. It's not talking about the peace we have as we're reconciled to God through the blood of Jesus. It's talking about our living down here. Live in peace with one another. And then Ephesians 4:3, Jackie, if you read that. And Robin's 1 Thessalonians 5:13, and Brad, 1 Timothy 2:2, and Maggie, Hebrews 12:14. Ephesians 4:3, Jackie.
Endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace.
In the bond of peace. This is God's will for Christians. Robin, 1 Thessalonians 5:13.
And to esteem them very highly in love for their work's sake, and be at peace among yourselves.
Be at peace among yourselves. And Brad, 1 Timothy 2:2.
For kings and for all that are in authority, we may lead a quiet and peaceable life in all godliness and honesty.
Quiet, peaceable life. And then Maggie, Hebrews 12:14.
Follow peace with all men and holiness, without which no man shall see the Lord.
So follow peace with all men. And 1 Peter 3:11 says, seek to seek peace. So number 40, if you're writing numbers, is that we're to have peace one with another. We're to get along. Now that goes back to the early one from way back in Matthew 5, to forgive and to reconcile. Those two definitely go together. But what God is saying is that we as God's children, because we have God dwelling in us, we have the capability, the capacity to live peacefully with one another through God's grace and God's help. And that is what God wants from each of us, to live peaceably one with another, at peace one with another. So that's number 40. Any questions about that? We'll go to Mark.
Okay, that verse on that Paul was saying, die to ourselves daily.
I die daily, yep.
Die daily, in a sense, basically starting over again. Basically, he's talking about keeping grudges and so forth, but when we die to ourselves daily, you basically get right again with God, in a sense, being reborn, in a sense, by ourselves.
Yep, that's 1 Corinthians 15:31. Paul said, I die daily. What he means is, we have to crucify ourselves every day. We have to reckon ourselves to be dead indeed unto sin, as it says in Romans chapter 6, Galatians 2:20. So we need to be dead to sin, and as he says, that means we can start each day afresh, walking in the Spirit of God, which gives us the capacity to live at peace with all. Yeah. Good. All right, Mark 10:19 is our next one, so if you want to turn there. This is interesting that in Matthew, when Jesus answered the question of the rich man, you remember that where the rich man came and said, what must I do to inherit eternal life? He's basically saying, what do I have to do? And Jesus basically said, well, you just got to be perfect and you go to heaven. And he basically said, well, I am perfect. And that's when Jesus said, well, then sell everything you have and give your money to the poor. Because he knew he was rich. And it says he walked away sorrowful, because he thought that he could earn his way to heaven, which, you know, we can't. But in that list, Jesus was listing the Ten Commandments of the Old Testament. But in Matthew, he didn't list this one. But he did here in Mark 10:19. So notice it says, thou knowest the commandments. Do not commit adultery, do not kill, do not steal, do not bear false witness. But then he says, defraud not. And he goes on to say, honor thy father and thy mother. So this defraud wasn't in Matthew, but it is an Old Testament commandment that Jesus is quoting, that we're not to defraud others. So what does defraud mean? To rob or to steal, exactly. It's still the word we use today, isn't it? Fraud is a word we use all the time. So we are never to defraud others. And in a lot of ways, the biggest emphasis there is financial, but you can defraud people in other things as well.
Usually his deception as part of it. You
know? Absolutely.
Yeah.
If you're defrauding someone, you're deceiving.
Kind of theft.
Yeah. Mm. It's a sneaky theft, if you will. So we'll see that this is sure enough a New Testament commandment that we're never to defraud others. So 1 Corinthians 6:8, Scott, and 1 Thessalonians 4:6, Brother Howard. So we're never to defraud others. 1 Corinthians 6:8, Brother Scott.
Yea, ye do no wrong, do wrong, and defraud, and that your brethren.
So Paul here is rebuking the Corinthians. And he's saying, you do wrong and defraud your brethren. That Christians were defrauding Christians. And he's rebuking the Corinthians for this. And then 1 Thessalonians 4:6, Brother Howard.
Let no man go beyond and defraud his brother in any matter, because that the Lord is the avenger of all such, as we also have forewarned you and testified.
Isn't that good? The Bible says the Lord is the avenger of all such. So God hates defrauding so much that he says he will avenge himself. It is an Old Testament commandment, but it's a New Testament commandment, as we see here. No man go beyond and defraud his brother in any matter. So it's never acceptable to defraud another person as a Christian. One of the commandments of our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. So any questions up to that point? Believe it or not, we're going to dive straight into John from here. There's no unique ones in Luke. We've covered them all. But in John chapter 4, there is a unique one. Verse 24. You're going to like this one. So, Brother Philip, could you read that for us? John 4:24.
God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth.
So, Jesus, remember, he was talking to the woman at the well, and he's saying, because she was trying to make a big deal about where people should worship physically, saying, should it be Jerusalem, should it be here in Samaria? And Jesus said, actually, God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. So, what is God saying? He's saying that we cannot truly worship him unless we are worshiping him in the Spirit. There's a lot of implications there, and that starts with the fact that if you're not born again, your spirit is dead. You can't worship God with a dead spirit. It needs life to be able to worship God. The Bible talks about how we are quickened by the Holy Spirit of God. Our spirit is given life. So an unsaved person cannot worship God. That worship, they can attempt to, but that worship is unacceptable because, well, number one, they aren't worshiping God through the blood of Jesus Christ, so they don't even have access to the throne. Number two, their spirit's dead. So you must worship God in spirit and in truth, which we'll talk about the truth part. So let's look at some scriptures on this. Mark Zeus, could you read John 9:31? And Robin, Acts 17:25, and Jackie, Romans 8:9, and Brad, Galatians 5:17, and Maggie, 1 Timothy 1:17. So this will give you a picture of what God is saying here. So John 9:31, Brother Mark says,
now we know that God heareth not sinners, but if any man be a worshipper of God, and doeth his will, him he heareth.
Does God hear sinners? Only for the prayer of salvation. Because, again, it's not through the blood of Christ, is it? So you must worship God in spirit. Now, Acts 17:25. Jack, go ahead.
Sorry, can I ask a question just on what you're saying there, not hearing the prayers of sinners? But can God direct people's lives who are not saved to direct them towards him? I mean, to...
Absolutely. I mean, God did that for all of us, didn't he? Drew us to himself. But what I'm saying is a sinner, and we're all sinners, but once you're born again, you're made righteous through the blood of Christ, right? So you're not really a sinner anymore. It's from a doctrinal point of view, as far as entering heaven in the future, those sins are gone. You're not a sinner. So it's, before you're saved, you're full of sin, and God doesn't allow that sin. So it's, if it's not covered by the blood of Jesus Christ, then you have no access. So an unsaved person can attempt to pray and say, God bless me this day, bless my family and all that, but they don't have access to the throne, do they? We're told to come boldly to the throne of grace. But who's he talking to? But people who are born again and have the righteousness of Christ applied to their account. Now, he obviously hears the prayer of salvation. If he didn't, none of us could get saved. But what I'm saying is we must worship him in spirit. Our spirit's dead until we're saved. So we can't worship God with a dead spirit. And you'll see there's other applications as well, as far as even worshiping God as Christians, which we'll talk about. But there's really multiple things in this. Number one, you can't worship God unless you're saved. But number two, you can't worship God in the flesh, as we'll see. Because God is a spirit. And, well, I'm jumping ahead of myself. The spirit and the flesh. flesh don't get along. Amen? So Robin, can you read Acts 17:25?
Neither is worshipped with men's hands as though he needed anything, seeing he giveth to all life and breath and all things.
So God isn't worshipped with men's hands. God is the Spirit. And then Romans 8:9, is that you, Brad?
That's me. But ye are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if so be that the Spirit of God dwell in you. Now if any man have not the Spirit of Christ, he is none of his.
If you're a Christian, you don't need to pray for the Holy Spirit. You have the Holy Spirit. And if you don't have the Holy Spirit, you're not saved. That's what Paul just said, isn't it? That's because he indwells us and he seals us to the day of redemption when we're born again. So here's the big one, Galatians 5:17. Was that Maggie?
Me.
It was Brad.
For the flesh lusteth against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. And these are contrary the one to the other, so that you cannot do the things that you would.
Why is this verse so critical? Because what it's saying is that we cannot worship God in the flesh. Because the flesh and the spirit are contrary one to the other. They're enemies of each other. And that is exactly why you cannot worship God with rock music. Now, you can feel good with rock music because it's designed to appeal to us, isn't it? The syncopated emphasis of the second and fourth beat instead of the first and the third beat. It's been around since basically the Beatles and Elvis. And now churches are using it like crazy. Drummers don't know any other way to play drums but to syncopate the beat. And it makes us feel good. Our flesh likes it. But if we go to church and our flesh is made to feel good and our emotions are made to feel good, we walk out saying, wow, I really worshiped God today. Did we? Or did we just feel good? Because God is holy and God is the Spirit. And we must worship him in spirit and in truth. Where were we worshiping him with our spirit or were we worshiping him with our flesh? Because God says you can't be both. They're contrary one to the other. You cannot worship God in the flesh. And then 1 Timothy 1:17 kind of seals it up. Was that you, Maggie?
Now unto the King eternal, immortal, invisible, the only wise God, be honor and glory forever and ever. Amen.
You see that word invisible? God is the Spirit. Now when we get to heaven, God allows us to see a manifestation of himself. But God is invisible because God is omnipresent. God is everywhere. God is all-powerful. God is all-knowing. God is not a single point in the universe, is he? That's why the Bible says here he's invisible. So that's what God is saying. We can only worship an invisible God in the Spirit. We cannot worship an invisible God in the flesh, or a holy God for that matter. So there's a lot of implications there. Number one, you got to be saved. You got to have a live spirit, not a dead spirit. Number two, you can't worship God in the flesh. You must worship him in the spirit. But then number three, it says, in spirit and in what else? Truth. Which means we must be worshiping him in accordance with his word. It must be true worship. It must be, number one, we're honest in our hearts about where we stand with God, right? Let's look at Psalm 145:21. I guess this kind of turned into a little mini sermon, but that's okay. Psalm 145:21. And so when we're worshiping God, we have to do it in truth. So that word carries two meanings as well. Not only truth in our hearts, in other words, we're true with God. We're not coming to God with false pretenses or with sin in our lives and saying, on the one hand, Lord, I love you and I'm worshiping you, you're holy, you're wonderful, but I'm living like the devil. That's not true. That's a lie. But number two, truth, it is, we're holding it in our hands, amen, in the Word of God. So it must be in accordance with the Word of God. So if our worship is contrary to the Word of God, it's not true worship. So we're not worshiping a true God. But notice Psalm 145:21. Look what it says. Oops. That's not the one I was thinking of. Where is it? Psalm 145:18. 21's a good verse too, but look at 18. The Lord is nigh unto all them that call upon him, to all that call upon him, what?
Shall
in truth. When we're calling upon God, when we're worshiping God, we must be doing it in truth. That's what Jesus said. They that worship Him must worship Him in spirit and in truth. So we cannot come to God lying. That's not truth. God is truth. And we cannot come to God in any way contrary to His own word. That's not true either, is it? So there's so much wrapped up in that verse. But the basic commandment is that we must worship God in spirit and in truth. It is a little S in John 4:24, isn't it? It's not the big S. It's not the Holy Spirit. It's our spirit. That's important. Note. Remember, we are a triune being, just like our Creator. He created us in His image. He is God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Ghost. We are body, soul, and spirit. Some people try to argue, if you go to 1 Thessalonians 5:23, some people try to argue that the soul and the spirit are one and the same. That's a little rubbish. The Bible says that they aren't the same. Most of you know Hebrews 4:12. The word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than a two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit. Well, how can you divide between the soul and the spirit if they're the same thing? And then notice here's 1 Thessalonians 5:23. Paul says, "And the very God of peace sanctify you wholly, and I pray God your whole spirit and soul and body be preserved blameless unto the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ." Well, if the spirit and the soul are the same thing, that verse doesn't make any sense, does it? But they aren't. They are separate. Our soul is who we are. Our body is this shell that we live in. And our spirit is where we get the capacity to serve and worship our holy God. And it's dead until we are saved. And it's injected or quickened with life from the Holy Spirit. So a little mini sermon there. But anyway, we need to worship God in spirit and in truth. That's number 42. Any questions? I know that went a bit long. Jackie?
Well, I was just thinking it's everything we do in our day ought to be a worship to God.
Absolutely.
That's right. So anything that we do that is not done as unto the Lord is, it's not in truth and it's not in the spirit.
That's right.
Is that correct? And we wear ourselves out when we're trying to do work in that regard, you know, when it's not done.
So true. Whether therefore you eat or drink, or whatsoever you do, what? You all to the glory of God. Worship isn't just what happens on Sunday morning, the church. Like Jack said, we should be constantly praising and worshiping the Lord all through the day. But we can only do it in the Spirit. So we must be yielded to the Spirit of God so that our spirit then can worship the Holy God. Any other questions before we go to John 12? Very important truth here in John chapter 12. Brother Mark Zeus mentioned it earlier, and that is that we are to die. There you go. One of the commandments is we all need to die. So notice John 12:23. Jesus answered them saying, "The hour has come that the Son of Man should be glorified. Verily, verily, I say unto you, except a corn of wheat fall into the ground and die, it abideth alone. But if it die, it bringeth forth much fruit. He that loveth his life shall lose it, and he that hateth his life in this world shall keep it unto life eternal. If any man serve me, let him follow me, and where I am, there shall also my servant be. If any man serve me, him will my Father." So who do you think that that corn of wheat is picturing? It's us, isn't it? Jesus says that we must die if we want to bring forth fruit. Now the bringing forth fruit is going to come up in chapter 15. But the point of this passage is that we are to die to self. And you'll be amazed at how many scriptures there are that talk about this great truth, that we need to die. So, Brother Scott, Luke 9:23, Howard, Romans 6:11, and Philip, Romans 12:1. Brother Scott, Luke 9:23. Watch this theme in the New Testament.
And he said to them all, if any man will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me.
What is the purpose of a cross? It's to kill, right? It's to execute someone. Jesus said we're to take it up how often?
Daily.
We must die daily, which Paul says in 1 Corinthians 15:31, I die daily. Okay, Brother Howard, Romans 6:11.
Likewise, reckon ye also yourselves to be dead indeed unto sin, but alive unto God through Jesus Christ our Lord.
What do you think the Lord means when he says, reckon yourselves to be dead? Me, reckon yourselves to be dead. Okay. What he's saying is, it's already doctrinally true. We are already dead. Our old man has already been crucified, right? But he's saying, you need to daily reckon it to be true. You need to daily, in your own mind, say, that old man is dead. I need to reckon it to be so. And I'm not going to listen to him today. He's going to be constantly giving me passes. He's going to be constantly telling me to do stuff I shouldn't do. He's dead. So reckon him to be dead. Stop listening to dead people. Amen. All right, Philip, Romans 12:1. We all know this verse.
Beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service.
A living sacrifice. When you sacrifice something, what do you do to it? If it's a living being, you kill it, right? You kill it. That's a sacrifice. In the Old Testament, they killed millions of lambs. They killed millions of cows. Millions of turtle doves. All to tell man that it takes death, it takes blood to pay for sin. Then we get to the New Testament, and we're told to be a living sacrifice. In other words, he doesn't want us to physically kill ourselves, but he does want us to sacrifice that old man. Every day is to die. All right, Galatians 2:20, Mark Zeus. A lot of people know this by heart, I know. Brad, Philippians 3, 7 and 8. And Jackie, Colossians 3, 3. So Mark, Galatians 2:20.
I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. Yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. In the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me.
So, Paul says, the life which I now live, I live by the faith of the Son of God. I live a new life, because the old man is crucified. Amen? Philippians 3, 7 and 8, Brad?
For what things are gained to me, those I count as loss for Christ. Yea, doubtless, and I count all things but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things, and do count them but done, that I might win Christ.
Amen. Everything is loss. It's all his. It's all gone. And then Colossians 3:3, let's seal it up, Becky.
For ye are dead, and your life is hid with Christ in God.
For ye are dead. So, to get to heaven, you must be born twice and die once. Amen? You must be born again. You have to have two birthdays. And then the old man is dead, crucified. To go to hell, you're going to die twice. You're going to physically die, and then you're going to eternally die. God says, I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God. That's the unsaved. They're dead. We're alive. Amen? We have eternal life. We will never die, we told John 11. So we are born twice. We've already died once. The old man is crucified. And Jesus said that corn of ground, or that corn of wheat, needs to fall into the ground and die if it's going to bring forth fruit. A process that scientists still don't completely understand. But he's teaching us a lesson about us, that if we're going to be a fruitful Christian, which we'll talk about in John 15, we must die to self. Just remember Paul's three words in 1 Corinthians 15:31, I die daily. Daily we need to die to self. Reckon ourselves to be dead. Because we already are. We are dead. Jackie just read it, Colossians 3:1. Any questions about number 43, die to self? So next week, John 13, one of our most well-known ones, Jesus said, a new commandment I give unto you, that you love one another. Well, we're told that in the Old Testament, so what makes it new? Well, the next verse says, as I have loved you. That makes it new. So we'll look at that next week and carry on in John. Lots of questions?